you said casually, since I don't believe in painting anymore.
I don't believe in painting because I hate objects, and I hate to go to museums and see pictures on the wall because they look so important and they don't really mean anything.
In 1957, pop artist Richard Hamilton listed the characteristics of pop art in a letter to his friends, the architects Peter and Alison Smithson. Pop art is popular, designed for a mass audience, transient, short-term solution, expendable, easily forgotten, low-cost, mass-produced, young, aimed at youth, witty, sexy, gimmicky, big business. Modernist critics were horrified by this description, particularly by the use of low subject matter and by the artist's apparent uncritical treatment of it. In fact, pop is one of the first manifestations of postmodernism, which is a reaction against the ideas and values of modernism, associated with skepticism, irony, and philosophical critiques of the concepts of universal truths and objective reality. Now, throughout the years, pop art has gained a reputation for being quote-unquote shallow or not real art. This is largely due to a fundamental misunderstanding and misconstruing of the spirit and function of pop art in the general public. And I have to confess, before I saw this exhibition, I did not see the point of it either, and I didn't consider modern art as real art either. I'm sorry. But seeing the masters of their era in their original canvases, in a terrible flash, I understood what I had been unwilling to accept. Pop art emerged in America in the 1950s, but it reached its peak in the 1960s. It began as a revolt against tradition, and the dominant approaches to art and culture wherein only upper elites could afford or even appreciate art. Young artists at the time felt that there was a huge disparity between what they were taught in schools and what they saw in museums versus what they saw in their daily lives. Let's talk about Andy Warhol. Why is he so famous? He is the central figure of pop art, in part because he self-consciously replaced the fine art tradition of perfection, beauty, and expression. Art was seen as a luxury, a status symbol for the elite and fodder for the highly educated, and he made it as ingrained in daily life as the tomato soup you're drinking. He manufactures art the way people manufacture goods because he is trying to bridge the separation of those two things. That is why he calls his art studio the factory. He willfully commodifies art because the soul of art has already been bastardized by the barrel of commodification. They claimed him controversial because he challenged the ways we think about art and, as a result, how we think about life and ourselves. By elevating the mundane as art, he is imploring us to elevate our own experiences and existences, to see meaning in meaninglessness, beauty in ugliness, spirituality in profanity, transcendence in the everyday and every man. He claimed, "The reason I am painting this way is that I want to be a machine." This, like many of his quotes, is easily taken at face value and misunderstood. He is not saying he wishes his humanity to be reduced to a mere machine. He is saying he wishes his humanity to be elevated in the machine, God in the machine. Not putting machines on a pedestal, but unifying human consciousness as godliness. Instead of cogs in a machine, we are neural links in a brain, interconnected, ever-reaching, ever-growing, living on forever and ever, invincible and immortal in our oneness. So the tomato soup can is us. It is the mundane as the spiritual, the monotonous as the sacred, the still life as the eternal. It is perfectly preserved. Even when we die, the tomato soup can lives. We may fail and regress, give up hope and control, but the spirit of the human race is undefeated, and undefeatable. That Campbell's Tomato Soup can print is worth $11.8 million. Warhol knew that even if his meaning was misconstrued and taken at face value, its essence would succeed him. It would live on with or without him. There is even a high kind of beauty in the irony it inspires. The fact that billionaires bid for a mere tomato soup can print is what elevates the art into irony. To miss such an obvious message that the whole thing becomes a parody, a satire, a dark comedy. But the limitations of humans is also what makes art meaningful. If there were no limits to the human mind, no challenges, no obstacles, there would be no art or need for art. As long as there is human frailty, there is need for art. Art relies on the failure of the individual and the collective. If failure is so ingrained in the human race, and is what makes the human race superior to the unnatural perfection of robots and machines, then there must be a way to harness that imperfection to its highest state, so that we might gain strength from error. And if error is built into our destiny, then we must make human error beautiful. We must imagine Sisyphus happy. That is why pop art, abstract art, modern art, by the way, sorry for lumping these in together, is not conventionally beautiful. It is not fine, it is coarse, it is heavy, it is messy, just like humanity. The beauty is not obvious, and that is what makes it beautiful. There is no delicate curve of an angel, no sacred geometry, no biblical perfection. There is a need for expressing the beautiful as the beautiful, but there is also a need for expressing the opposite. Without beauty, how will we live? And without ugliness, how can there be beauty? Pop art was another kind of renaissance. It was not an angelic rebirth, but a screaming, writhing, painful one. The blood of the mother, the intestinal ache, the nausea, the grossness of the placenta. It forces you to confront the pain of life and the divinity of that pain. We didn't arrive at our parents' windowsills by stalks. We didn't wake up one day enlightened. We scratched and clawed for some semblance of meaning in an otherwise uncaring world. Who decides what is beautiful and what is ugly? Meaningful or meaningless? Man's mind? What is mind? The body is the instrumental gauge of the heavenly intelligence. Bear with me, I wanted to talk about a specific painting of his that I saw that had a great impact on me, which I did not expect. It was his Cross 1982 painting. I did not expect to have this kind of reaction to an Andy Warhol painting, and certainly not to a simple cross on a black background. I am not religious, and I don't know if any of these artists were religious, but to me that defeats the point. This has nothing to do with religion, but existence, and how we all cope with it. It is a bright neon yellow cross on a pitch black background. It stands alone on a wall, the focal point. The cross symbol is unavoidable, internationally known, often revered, often appalled. It is not unspeakable, but it is unknowable. Staring into the pulsing yellow light of the cross, you start to lose yourself. It is not unlike a portal, sucking you into another dimension. But as you walk back, without taking your eyes off it, the corners of the yellow cross start to fade and blur with your vision. It goes out of focus, and the darkness of the black paint starts to bleed into the edges. But there it throbs like a distant, bright light at the end of an endless tunnel. The yellow cross is a subject of meditation, no matter who you are. It demands a deep focus, like a lighthouse in a deafening storm. Staring into it, you let it blur into yourself until there is no separation. You walk back and go in. You let it go straight into your chest. It awakens you and makes you question. It feels safe yet unknown, yet makes you notice the safety in that unknown. The beauty of that surrender. It scares and soothes you. Either way, it pulls you, standing out like a spot of light in the eternal darkness. If you close your eyes and surrender to that, the ultimate self is realized in nothingness. Since the painting is very tall, it dwarfs and looms over you, so to see all of it, you must look up or at a distance. How does the yellow glow, you will think? It pulses and blinds and thrusts itself out of the painting, out of the darkness, even when the darkness invades. It can't just be a trick of the light. There is a door in there calling. It beckons and floats and magnifies. It challenges you to reverence. And now the symbol becomes no longer important. The cross is not the point. It's simply the lever of the point. I'm afraid that if you look at a thing long enough, it loses all of its meaning, Warhol said. Look at the cross for long enough, and you will find that there is no you or it. There is no icon to worship, no symbol to absolve you. There is only you, in accordance with the silent infinity. Warhol put himself in the cross, standing bright amongst the enveloping darkness. Whatever that means to him, whether it was religious or spiritual or survival, he obviously had no idea where to go. But even in his most confused state, he is still anchored. He is not moved. He actually still connects to that pillar of light, even though the darkness has already seeped through. You cannot deny the existence of that cross. It is not negotiable. That cross is there, has always been there, and it will be there until the end of man. So that cross may also represent his confusion, his dream, his lack of direction. But it also represents his direction. And that is why it is eternal. Because every single person goes through that struggle, just not every single person knows how to capture that moment. How to capture that moment when he's right in the middle of this crossroad. And with Warhol, something I noticed is that some people may call him pretentious. And yes, maybe, but he is so honest, so brave, and so sincere in his pretentiousness that it ceases to be pretentious. Does that make sense? The cross painting is not without irony either, as there is always a streak of it in Warhol's works. You can't help but notice the blaring cross is likened to a neon yellow motel sign, flashing brokenly at passers-by for a warm drink or a quick lay. Bastardization and commodification of religion, or more precisely, the soul. There is a dark humor in that, that Warhol acknowledges. But again, he doesn't let that cynical truth compromise the painting. This leads me to Jean-Michel Basquiat.
I'd like to remain a little reclusive and not be just and be out there, you know, just to, you know, to be brought up and be brought down, you know, like they do to most of them.
Yeah, sometimes they can tell on you, don't they?
Well, they always do. I can't think of one big celebrity type person who they haven't done that to.
They
tend
not to.
Here and there.
Standing in front of his original paintings, all I could think was, starving, hysterical, naked. Like Allen Ginsberg, Basquiat saw the best minds of his generation destroyed by madness. And that madness is life-giving, as shown in his art, but it is also destructive. The elemental forces of life. He doesn't run from it, contradict it, fight against it, provide a solution for it. He falls face first into the abyss and finds pleasure in the darkness. He screams in agony and the expression is so intense that it becomes pleasurable. His paintings often have a grotesque focus of anatomy, darkness, animalism, and formlessness. standing in front of his many untitled works, I heard his suffering, I felt his pain, and I witnessed his celebration. Untitled. No name, no shape, no face, no identity, is where personhood is found. Witnessing his painting in the flesh, you start to realize things. The anatomy of the body, the bloody bones, the pumps and valves of life are all spiritual. The gallbladder, the scrotum, the heart, the spleen, God's pubic hair, all sing the body electric. It is fragile, vulnerable, easily bled. It is religion and resurrection, the sacrament of God. Layman, scholar, criminal, saint are interchangeable here. We are all living in the pocket of God. It is dark and cramped, but we feel safe in the control we have willingly given up. We swear because words have no meaning. We scream because nobody hears. Hopelessness is freeing. Loneliness is unifying. Basquiat's paint reminds me of saints in their last hours, vultures pecking at their livers and growing back for eternity. Basquiat is balancing on the meridian of life and death in his most primordial form. He is animalistic, yet intellectual. He is radical, yet sentimental. He is nihilistic, yet optimistic. He is brave and he is afraid. His barbaric instincts, his rage and confusion, and his certainty, his romanticism, is a chimeric creature in the wilderness. The jungle is existence. Against one of the walls was a collaboration between Basquiat and Warhol, who were friends in real life. Of course, it was untitled. It was, to say the least, a bleak, savage work. There was a large skull, black and white, slathered paint, and next to it was a big red blot with the word stomach on it. I found it curious. It was an undoubtedly confusing work, going off the plaque's description on the side and the reactions of the spectators behind me. But staring at it, for you have to stare a long time at these works, I thought, amidst the confusion and fright of the bare, starving bones, the hollow skull, it is all formlessness. All questions without answers. Yet blaring red in this draining picture is the stomach. It knows itself and its name. The intestines, the guts of life, roaring, humming, driving blood, bare bones, cage of nothing. In nothing, everything remains. No labels needed, no thought, no logic, just feeling. Our primordial sense is certainty in uncertainty. The rest falls away. Only the stomach knows itself, digesting, processing, pumping. The gut is the mind. It listens and it knows. It's a conversation without words. It's a knife in the side, bleeding out forever. Now, while you process that stream of consciousness, I will remind you of a famous Basquiat quote. I want to make paintings that look like it was made by a child. Basquiat knew that the art made by a child is the purest and most sincere expression of self. It is without ego, pretentiousness, greed, pride, trauma, or performance. It is its truest, simplest form, and in that simplicity lies the greatest truth. Coloring outside the conventional lines, letting your imagination and instinct guide you, the optimism and hope. When we become children again, that is real art. And by making that kind of art, he forces people to look at it as if they were a child in order to understand it. And by that, he makes people get in touch with the child that they lost. It becomes not just art, but an experience of dismantling, reconnecting, rebuilding, and reconciling.
I mean, these are just sort of primordial or primal symbols of humanity and life. I mean, the way people's distinction between humans and animals and what that distinction means, or why people think they're more important than animals, or
Now this leads me to Keith Haring. Largely printed above his paintings was his quote, "I am not a beginning. I am not an end. I am a link in a chain." On main display was his huge painting, untitled, 1981. Like many of his paintings, it is composed of interconnecting labyrinthine lines of red and green on a white background. In the center are two wolves, a recurring motif in his works. Staring at it, all I could think was, "We are all links in the chain. The chain is the cycle of suffering we are bound to. The connection between birth and death, animal and human, primitive and sacred. It keeps us ravaged to shreds, wailing but content in our fear, happy to be lost. The chain keeps us locked in the order of our chaos and the chaos of our order. Only when we break this chain can we be truly free." Cue Fleetwood Mac's The Chain. Many times during this exhibition, I thought of saints and martyrdom. Why, I don't know. Burned to the stake, tortured on the rack, flayed alive, speared to the side, head on the barracks. An example, I thought. An eternal life. That is humanity. So the hidden iconography of saints is profane yet sacred, yet mocking, yet compassionate in its mockery. Pop art. Cheapness, tackiness, kitsch. Prints of Marilyn Monroe, Dolly Parton, Mao. Exaggerated ideals who fell to the majority. Picked apart, idolized to the point of non-existence. Pop art begs you not to rationalize, intellectualize, assign meaning, connoisseurize. It is carnivorous and nauseating. Tasteless kitsch is optimism. Drag is realism. Art is anything you can get away with. I am sorry that I am literally regurgitating my thoughts in such an unclear manner, but like the pop artists, I am not going to assign myself a rule to follow. This is how I felt. This is what I saw. Everything I say here is my own perspective, not indicative of the artist's intentions. Warhol might have painted the soup cans because he just loved eating soup that much. Who knows and who cares? And to hell with those who try to pry into the artist's mind. I am finally arriving at Mark Rothko. He wasn't included in the pop artist's exhibit, but I am still mentioning him because I want to talk about a particular painting of his that inspires the same reaction. It is his Untitled Red 1969. Now many people, including past me, might look at a picture of a Rothko painting and go, "What? How is this artistically revered? It's just blocks of colored paint. Anyone can do that." Now there's where we're wrong. Rothko is an alchemist. His Untitled Red is not just a rectangular painting with red blocks of paint. It is a portal to another world. Much like the cross, it beckons you, it sucks you in, it submerges you, and it transcends you. The rectangle is much shaped like a door. Indeed, it beckons you to walk through it. But what must be at the other side? That is the question and the thing we all fear. Yet we all must let go of that fear, our need to know and control and understand. Once we surrender to not knowing, we may find the Pierian spring. It will reveal itself to you in the moments of absolute emptiness and humility. A painting is not a picture of an experience, but is the experience. As Rothko said, for me, it is like looking out from a spaceship, down at the beautiful splash of blue in the darkness, which is Earth. It will seem very far away, yet it will call to you. You will long to go down, to go back home. You will think, the abyss is very cold and lonely and dead indeed. And the abyss will stare right back at you. That is what you feel when looking at Rothko's untitled Red. There are even certain films that can emulate this feeling, at least for me, of existential kind of astral projection and depersonalization. This makes one even more aware of their humanity, because you begin to miss it. For example, the match cut sunset scene, the famous scene in Lawrence of Arabia. The sunset is a lake of fire, still and impenetrable, and never ending. It brings tears to your eyes to stare into it, for you feel like you're falling down a bottomless well, afraid for where you're going, but happy to be weightless, like a biblical man seeing an angel for the first time. Now, all this comes to the concluding question. What is the difference between these masters of pop art and the modern artists of today? Not to sound like a stuck-up purist, but the masters' creations were about survival. The reason why their art is so sincere is because they were so hungry in their soul. They were so spiritually starving, and they had no place in the world at that time, no outlet. They had to struggle to survive, spiritually, emotionally, and physically. Whatever they saw was completely pointless. And when a person is very hungry, they see things that people in comfort do not. It was a revolutionary statement, challenging controversy and status quo, but it was also extremely personal. The stakes were extremely high because their souls were on the line. They weren't trying to make a big speech with their art or regurgitate themselves onto the canvas. They understood that man must have bread to live, while also knowing that he cannot live by bread alone. It's true, times have changed for the better, but must art suffer for it? The questions of a man's soul have not yet been solved and never will be solved. We have not yet run out of questions to ask, dilemmas to ponder, needs to be met. But Rothko said it better.
When I was a younger man, art was a lonely thing. No galleries, no collectors, no critics, no money. Yet it was a golden age, for we all had nothing to lose and a vision to gain. Today it is not quite the same. It is a time of tons of verbiage, activity, consumption. Which condition is better for the world at large, I shall not venture to discuss. But I do know that many of those who are driven to this life are desperately searching for those pockets of silence where we can root and grow. We must all hope we can find them. A Portofino, rivedo te. Ricordo un angolo di cielo.